Hello, I'm V.B. Price. I'm the editor of New Mexico Mercury. I'm here today in the Mercury Library with dear friend Sherri Brueggemann, who's the City of Albuquerque's Public Art Program Manager. Public Arts in Albuquerque celebrated its 35th anniversary this October. It's contributed 817 pieces of public art to Albuquerque's urban culture. Most of it right out in the world and right out in the weather for all to see. Public art is one of our city's great triumphs, in my view, along with the Albuquerque Museum, the preservation of open space on the West Mesa volcanoes, and above the 10% grade on the Sandia Mountains. All were started in the 1970s, of all things, because it was perhaps the most far-sighted period in modern Albuquerque history. Sherri's here to talk with us today about the fascinating evolution of public art in Albuquerque. She's a founding member, and let me get this right, of the Americans for the Arts Public Art Network. She's also a former printmaker, winery owner, and is currently a professor of practice at the University of New Mexico's College of Fine Arts. Sherri, it's just great to have you with us today.
Thank you so much. It's truly, truly a privilege and honor to be here having a chat with you about public art.
You know, Albuquerque is an amazing place, as we know, in so many different ways. And who would think, really, with all the terrible bad-mouthing we get from certain areas, that we would have a major public arts presence, and a very important one in the scope of the American West, it seems to me. Could you tell us a little bit about the history of how this came to be, and maybe our place in the West as a public arts presence?
Sure. Well, the very first Albuquerque Arts Board was actually initiated by Mayor Harry Kenney. He put the first group of people together to start talking about arts and culture and the role of city government, mm-hmm. and how that relates. And they were charged with doing a lot of things. They were more like a big city arts commission. They were looking at the visual arts and the performing arts and looking at different policy things that could come together under that early city government. This was only 5 years after the city charter was officially put into place, which was around 1977 is when the first arts board was established. About a year later is when the first official 1% for art ordinance was established, and that was actually right at the transition time between Harry Kenney and David Rusk. So the ordinance was signed by David Rusk, but there was a transition of board members who actually kicked off the first public art program, so to speak. And the funding for the public art program was set up as 1% of the general obligation bonds. So every time the voters go to the polls to vote on new capital construction for the city, whether it's new bike trails, new roads, new fire stations, new swimming pools, or libraries, 1% of the budget is added to the overall budget. So we're truly a addition and enhancement of art. We're not a penalty. It's not 1% taken away from a construction budget. It's added to the construction budget.
Why did we have this impetus to do public art? And why have we become so important, really, around the country? It seems unlikely to me, actually. But I'm so thrilled that we are.
Well, interestingly, the Albuquerque Public Art Program was the 15th official 1% for art program in the country.
Wow.
Philadelphia is the oldest one. They were the first one to actually establish an ordinance. There are a couple other large cities. Actually, the state of Hawaii was like around number 11, 12, 13, something like that. And so here Albuquerque came as number 15 and kind of caught that wave of what was going on at the National Endowment for the Arts and what was going on in some of the bigger metropolitan areas around the country of, you know, doing this dedicated budgeting of money for arts, primarily integrated into architecture, but also for large outdoor sculptures. And it was kind of during the era of the big plop art sculpture.
Big plop art.
And plop art sculpture was sort of a way of having, demonstrating civic pride in the public spaces. And there was that group of people here in Albuquerque that had Harry Kenny's ear that really kind of got this started and said, you know, we need to be doing that. If we're going to be a big grown-up metropolitan city, then we need to have some of this kind of artwork.
So, you know, we live in probably the most beautiful natural environment on Earth, my judgment anyway. And to suddenly to be driving around town and to be seeing these wonderful, oftentimes eccentric, oftentimes completely unexpected, even if you've seen them dozens of times, not to mention the statues of Dennis Chavez and Harry, you know, those people, but just to have that presence integrated into daily life, which is what we try to do with poetry and the Mercury. We try to not segregate it into some sort of special category, but to make it a part of the living world. And I know that's what public arts intends to do, and they do it so beautifully. Could you discuss a little bit about the philosophy behind that? And because I think it's fascinating.
So by the law, the intent for the public art program was set up with three major goals, which is to further the development, the public awareness of, and the interest of the fine arts and crafts as a, you know, a civic sort of civic pride, and, you know, giving the citizens opportunity to have access to artwork. It also has a very interesting early economic component. The intent in the ordinance says that it's also to establish increased employment opportunities for artists.
Wow.
So really talking about keeping artists employed in our community. And then when the ordinance was revised in around 1991, they added another one in to have a little more emphasis on making sure that public art was integrated into architecture, into the buildings that we were building. But I think those first two purposes of you know, with the founders who wrote the law of, you know, really making it a civic responsibility to allow public art to be out there for the citizens and to think about employing our artists was really significant.
Yeah.
And I think in response to this beautiful environment that we're in, you know, we know all the history of artists coming here to New Mexico and loving our environment. We've actually acquired an amazing amount of public artworks that are about our beautiful environment and the inspiration that comes from that. So our public art might not be the biggest, grandest scale public art, but it definitely says something about who we are here. And I think that there was also another little undercurrent in the community at that time. There was a lot of effort going into getting the Albuquerque Museum established,
right,
which of course a museum's function is to, you know, collect and preserve and showcase and be able to educate about our history, where in my mind public art is very much forward looking. The whole process of public art is about creating something that has not been made before, and really looking about sites and places and the way people use them and what do we want to say about our public spaces with a very forward-looking sort of perspective. So I think that the balance between the emphasis and the interest in the museums in preserving and then public art and looking forward was kind of an interesting, you know, catalyst for what was going on in Albuquerque at the time.
So to think that Albuquerque, of all places, would be concerned with helping artists earn a living is to me a great testament to our kind of collective spirit. Clearly that's a WPA idea on one level, but to have it move into the 1970s and 80s and 90s is extraordinary because there are so many wonderful artists here. And I can remember the first time I started to see on bus stops tiled representations or stone representations, other kinds of things of the river. I mean, you think, oh, this is reflecting where we are. It's just it's wonderful stuff. So I know that there is a kind of an undercurrent between placing public art everywhere, having a whole lot of it everywhere, and having the big sort of historical monumental works that cost a whole bunch of money and that sort of celebrate perhaps the political life of an office holder. Has that been a part of the evolution here?
For the past year or so, I've been working on kind of doing a history of the public art program, really doing digging down deep into the policy, doing a policy analysis. And one of the things I had to do to get at that was review 35 years worth of the Arts Board minutes. The meetings and kind of track what was going on and look at the project files and see like what was the artist dealing with. And so I learned a great deal about the history of this program. And there was an Arts Board chairperson, Mary Carol Nelson, who is also a visual artist and a writer here in Albuquerque at the time. And she wrote sort of this early manifesto for the public art program. And she wrote about a bunch of ideas about where public art should be. And this is only like 5 years into the program. There wasn't a lot going on then. And basically, she said that, you know, we want to make sure we have some in all of the neighborhoods. We think the public art should be for everybody. And Albuquerque's growing. And we should have something that is sort of iconic that people remember when they come to Albuquerque. But she wasn't so concerned with making sure that we had sort of the big blue chip artist sculpture in Albuquerque. What she really wanted at the end, the way she sort of summarized it, was that she wanted a public art program that demonstrated that we really cared for artists and for arts and culture. And in a roundabout way, she sort of set the tone for saying, the more the merrier. We should have public art everywhere. We should showcase all the amazing talent that we have here in Albuquerque, in New Mexico, and bringing in talent from around the country, internationally, even if possible. But I could tell by reading that information that there was already starting to be a little discussion about, should we do something big and monumental? There was actually an idea on the books then at that time of doing a... This is really early and very cutting edge at the time, doing a monumental laser sculpture where laser lights would be placed at all the gateways of the interstate at the edges of the city, and they would all point up into the sky and make a pyramid.
Wow.
Yeah, this is light-based laser art in Albuquerque in the early 1980s.
Wow.
And we didn't really even see that realized nationally until probably the late 1990s or the 2000s. And then especially after the World Trade Center came down and there was that light installation that went on in the ghost of the building. Yeah. But to think about what was going on with the ideas in Albuquerque at that time in this discussion between lots of good art in all the little neighborhoods so that everybody can enjoy it in a park or in a swimming pool or in a library versus, no, let's do the thing that's never been done before. We put a big laser pyramid over the entire city and probably, you know, evoke some good energy being under a pyramid, right? So that discussion's been going on for a long time and it continues till today, literally. Yesterday. At our arts board meeting, you know, 88 board members later, still talking about that idea of how do we get that one big piece of public art that just says Albuquerque.
Wow. So you gave me a copy actually the other day of the new New York City cultural plan, in which they really emphasize neighborhood services in a lot of ways, like that wonderful early board member did. And so it's kind of, but you've also done a survey of what Albuquerqueans want to see. And I'd like to talk about that survey, particularly in relationship to the big monument, if there is such a thing still possible.
Yes, that New York City cultural plan thing is very exciting. And I think it's definitely a plan that, you know, most big cities are going to be looking at too. Maybe we should too. But we did do a survey last December and early January. We actually designed it as a two-part survey for locals and tourists. And we partnered with the Convention and Visitors Bureau and they sent it out to like, I don't know, a couple thousand people that had recently come to Albuquerque. So of the survey, 50% were locals and 50% were tourists. And we asked the tourists if they came here, you know, what they came here for. Most of it was for leisure, some business. We asked them if they noticed public art when they got here. And just about 80% of the people said yes, absolutely. Really? And that, you know, the majority of them were going to leave with a new awareness of public art, and that it was something that they didn't realize Albuquerque had that much of. And we even asked them a question: since you've been back from your trip, have you talked about Albuquerque public art? And believe it or not, a fairly decent percentage of people not only talked about where they went and what they did and what they ate, but they mentioned public art.
Wow.
So that was really encouraging.
Yeah.
On the local side, we ask a lot more questions about what they wanted to see. And there was a lot of interest in having more art on the bike trails, more art downtown, which is interesting because we actually have a lot of art downtown.
Yeah,
it's not the big monumental thing that maybe everybody knows exactly where it is, but we have a lot of pieces downtown. They wanted to see artwork in more recreational areas. Some of our destination locations, like the convention center, and you know, adding more art to the airport. But we did finally get down to in the level of questions and ask them, if the city of Albuquerque were to do a very large, iconic, monumental public artwork, where would you want to see it? And the majority, well, the highest ranking location, we gave them certain locations, and then we said other, but the highest ranking location was the rail yards. So if the rail yards get developed, they wanted to see a large artwork at the rail yards. Next in line was Civic Plaza, which everybody kind of gravitates to Civic Plaza, but the way it's built can't really support a really big artwork unless we figure out how to suspend it from the buildings and hang it from the sky. Exactly.
Yeah,
right. Next were the gateways, what I mentioned about, you know, the gateways coming into Albuquerque on the interstates.
Right.
After that was the Big Eye. Only 14% of the people wanted to see something at Central Avenue and the river, which was kind of interesting because I know there's a lot of us that think of that as the heart of the city.
Yeah.
And think that maybe something there big that ties in with the biopark and Tingley Beach and Route 66 crossing the river. You know, this seems to have a good vibe to it, but I'm not exactly sure how that site would work. And then finally, some people, about 10% of the people, thought Balloon Fiesta Park would be a good location for it. So,
what an interesting spread.
Yeah, it is, you know, but I would have not, I was really surprised when people said the rail yards.
Yes,
because
me
it's,
too.
At that point, you know, there was just getting some momentum. You know, the city through the Municipal Development Department, the Planning Department, the Metropolitan Redevelopment Authority, the Cultural Services Department are just now getting their head around being able to use, you know, one of those spaces for public events and activities. And we're looking at putting some art events in there, obviously. But I thought that was really interesting that the community thought that the rail yards was the place where a big monumental piece should go.
Fascinating. So I know that you mentioned that that 1%, which always strikes me as being a tiny amount, has really generated, what, $14 million or so? Or it's a lot of money, and because it's an add-on, it doesn't take from anything. It truly is an urban enhancement, which is a wonderful idea. And I'm just so impressed with that and so glad for that. Has anybody sort of mentioned kind of like what kind of big monument that they might be looking for? Or, I mean, are there sort of factional ideas, or is there one thing that sort of falls out all the time, or is it just chaos?
Well, there's certainly been the discussion about the big, huge red and green chili in the middle of the Big Eye, right?
Is it really?
Well, you know, that comes up.
Sure.
That comes up. I still like the, you know, the laser light pyramid going over the whole city. That's kind of fun. That really would seriously encompass the whole city. But, you know, I think that's part of the challenge is thinking about it, because normally what happens, or oftentimes what happens, is that, you know, artists kind of come up with these ideas. And our job, what we normally do, is we identify the space, and the site is tied into the funding source. So we're challenged with making sure that we have a large sum of money that's we can put in one site, because if it's 1% that we spend by bond purpose, we can spend it on roads, we can spend it, you know, by parks, in parks, you know, and other construction development sites that the city's investing in. And so that's kind of our challenge right now, is the way we could cobble the money together based on a site. So that's why we're looking at places where we've got a lot of municipal activity already happening, so we can cobble the funds together. But there's definitely been some ideas about, you know, something tall. If you're going to say something big, it needs to be something tall, but also maybe having somewhat of a functional purpose of being able to get up on this tall thing and look out over our landscape.
Oh.
Because, you know, a lot of people hike to the mountains and look back over the city, or you hike to the petroglyphs and you look back over the city.
Yeah.
You know, there's a few buildings in downtown where you can get up high enough and look out the windows and see over the city. But, you know, that's an idea that's certainly floating around out there. I think a significant tall structure that you could get up high enough that would hold people, even if they, you know, went up however way with a mini elevator or stairs or whatever.
Mm.
It's going to be a little more than what our budget can fund right now.
Right.
But, you know, maybe the public art is the embellishment of some sort of observation tower. And that could be another way that we engage with our environment, being able to look at it from a different perspective.
So we've been talking about this big number, 817 works of public art. Could you sort of get that into a little more of a specific light and talk about probably the 10 most famous ones or most observed ones, and then maybe the 10 underdogs that you would like to have more people see?
Sure. I certainly have my favorites, especially the underdogs, the ones that I know that are out there that maybe not everybody knows. Just to give you a little bit of an overview, though, there's about not quite two-thirds of that 800 and some works of art are two-dimensional or smaller indoor pieces.
Okay.
So only really about a third are the big ones outdoors. And
wow.
A lot of people don't realize how many smaller works of art that we actually have in the collection. And some of those, a lot of those hang in libraries inside City Hall. We have almost 300 works of art inside City Hall. That's a great place to take a tour. And
wow.
Many of the pieces, my sort of underdog favorites, are in City Hall.
Okay.
We've done a couple of really great projects. We've partnered with the Tamarin Institute,
yeah.
where we've invited artists to go print with them, learn a new technique, and some of those artworks are hanging in there. We've also acquired artworks from high school students as part of the Metro Youth Art Exhibition that takes place every spring. The students that go through art schools pick their best piece and they get juried in. And then we offer a purchase award. So we have student art in the collection. We have just so many kinds of you know, tapestries, weavings, photography. You know, the collection is really, I like to call it encyclopedic, because it has a little bit of everything, whether that's the medium or the subject matter. But some of them, I brought my little cheat sheet here so I can remember the names of them. But there's this great piece. There's like three of them all on one floor. It turns out to be City Council's floor, on the ninth floor of City Hall, that are some of the prints that were done at Tamarin this past round. And there's some by Evan Dent, and there's one of them that I just love, and it's called "You're Not From Around Here." And it's just the look on this character's face. There's another one by Margie Weir that was also printed at Tamarin, and it's sort of like a tapestry, but it's a weaving together of all these symbols and images of New Mexico.
Whoa.
that when you first look at it, you think it might be a rug or a weaving, but then you realize it's really sort of this postcard looking design that includes things like nuclear symbols and wind turbines and roadrunners and chilies and corn. I mean, it's just an amazing piece.
That's
and
great.
Those are some of them inside City Hall. You know, I can talk about, like, I can go on and on and on and talk about public art, but
there's 817 of them.
I know. Some of the stories is why I love them. I mean, you know, because I know the story behind them and what goes on. So, like, last year we did the Center of the City markers. There was an article that came out in the journal about where the center of the city was.
Mm.
Geographically, the GIS guys put their heads together and their computer programs and figured out, based on land that's actually in the city limits, where the exact center of the city was. And it turned out it was basically where the old train used to be at Coronado I think it's Coronado Park, just south of the interstate on 4th Street.
On 4th Street.
Yeah, so right there where the old big black train used to be was the center of the city. And this was in 2012, and so that we were celebrating the centennial, so we said, well, where was the center of the city 100 years ago?
What a good idea.
GIS guys were all over that. They went back and figured it out, and they did this, you know, center of the city through time, got back 100 years, and it turns out it's on 4th Street, about half a block south of Central. So we did these.
Wow, what a
we did a competition for these manhole cover like markers, and we did a design competition, and then we took care of getting them cast, which we actually partnered with Las Vegas, the university in Las Vegas,
Highlands.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. We partnered with their foundry, their student foundry, and actually poured these manhole covers in a design that a very young artist from San Miguel, New Mexico, designed. So I just love the unbelievable amount of collaboration and that and that kind of story. So that's kind of like a little unknown, you know, one. Sure. Then we have other pieces like the Charles Ross prisms in the convention center. Now, Charles Ross is definitely one of those amazing, incredible sort of blue chip artists. It's not like he's, you know, selling huge amounts of stuff and, you know, through the auction houses these days, but he's just such an incredible thinker about land, about the stars and moon and light. And so we have these prisms in the convention center that are supposed to cast these rainbows on the floor.
Oh my God.
I have a new sense of appreciation for those. The convention center is undergoing remodel right now, and we're working on getting them cleaned so that the light can come through them and just cast these beautiful rainbows all over the floor. God. And again, those are some of those things that people just don't even know that are there.
So how about the big famous ones?
Well, so of course everybody knows our beloved Cruising San Mateo.
Yes.
Which has a nickname, which I'm not supposed to say because that's we were supposed to call it by its real title, but of course everybody knows it's the Chevy on a stick. Everybody, you know, everybody knows about that one. I think the very soon to be famous one is the one that we just dedicated, which is the new Fire Rocket, which is on the other end of Gibson. It's a sort of a Buck Rogers-esque rocket shooting up, but it's at a fire station, so it's painted and designed to look like a fire station rocket, which is about delivering, you know, public safety services at the speed of light, you know, and how fast they are. So that's going to be a new famous one. We certainly have the pieces like the Dennis Oppenheim piece at UNM, which is on Lomas, just across from the health services, the University Hospital. That's, again, another famous one because the artist is very renowned. You know, it was actually voted America's Ugliest Sculpture in Choir Magazine. You know, I'm not sure how much weight that holds, but you know, that's kind of famous. So, you know, we definitely have our kind of iconic pieces that everybody knows. I think the ceramic tile mural around the east wing of the convention center, everybody who sees that loves it. And I can't tell you, I mean, how pleased I am with that project, because it's just, you know, 13 years worth of kids being involved and working with artists and telling the story of New Mexico in those handmade tiles. And then for the culminating section that we did last year, Hakeem Bellamy, our poet laureate, worked with the students and actually wrote some poetry with them that got embedded into the ceramic mural. I mean, they actually carved little individual letters and glazed them and grouted them right into the poem. It's just incredible. God. And I think that's part of what makes public art so amazing, is that the amount of detail and craftsmanship and work that goes into these things, that you might catch it when you're driving by a couple of times and think about it, but if people knew that they could get out of their car and go up close and look at it, they'd be amazed at what people are making with their hands.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah. So one of the greatest works of art, public art, I guess, that I've ever seen produced by an Albuquerque person is a work called 1,000,000 Bones, and I know that the public arts program here, by ordinance, wasn't allowed to have all that much role in it, but that you're now working on it here to bring it back home. Could you talk about that a little bit?
You're right. The way the ordinance is set up is that we spend the money within the city limits, and we have the luxury of being able to partner with other agencies. So when the state has 1% for art, we can combine it together. We've partnered with the county. They have 1% for art. But the 1 Million Bones Project was conceived of by an Albuquerque artist, but it was the whole intent was for this installation to take place on the National Mall in Washington, D.C. And it didn't have the sense of permanence. It was a temporary installation, didn't have that sense of permanence that we also require. Yeah. I participated in 1 Million Bones. I didn't actually make any of the bones, but when I saw the small sort of test run installation take place here in downtown Albuquerque, I was so moved and choked up by that. I said that, you know, if they pull this off and they can make this thing happen in Washington, D.C., I'm going. Mm-hmm. And I did. I booked my vacation around it, and I went out there, and I still get choked up thinking about it because it was such an amazing project. So when it was all over, I realized, after looking at these 1 million bones laid out on the National Mall on that Sunday, there's a lot of material here that's going to have to go somewhere. It's going to have to find a home when it comes back. There were a lot of bones that were made out of paper mache or you know, degradable sort of materials, unfired clay, those kinds of things. But there was art bones made out of things from metal and glass and just all these amazing, beautiful objects that I thought to myself, we need to find a permanent home for this. So in talking with Naomi and Suzanne and the people who really brought this together, I asked them what their intent was, and they said, yeah, we would like to find a permanent place for it. And I said, well, I think if you bring it home to Albuquerque, we can then try to help, because it would be a permanent installation. It would be in the Albuquerque limits. And, you know, this might be something that we can build on as a really important installation in Albuquerque. So I was able to report to the Arts Board my experience out there and showed them some pictures and kind of gave them a little teaser about, you know, the idea of bringing this installation home. And so we're meeting to talk about with some really smart, talented, creative people in the city to think about where would be a permanent home for this installation and how it could be installed in a way that would be meaningful. And it can't be laid out the way it was in Washington, D.C., just one layer, you know, taking up all this space. There would have to be some sort of other installation so that people could really see the impact of the message, but also, again, like what I just said, get up close to these objects and see what people made with their hands.
Yeah.
So I'm going to work on it personally and professionally to see if we can't find a place for it.
So 1 Million Bones, created by Naomi Vitale, needs, I would think, a pretty big space. Could we talk a little bit about what some of the parameters are for this? And I certainly hope it happens here. I was so deeply moved too. I'm just blown away by it.
Well, it's very early discussions about this, but obviously they want it outdoors. They do not want an interior installation. So it's not like going into a space. It really needs to have that outdoor presence. They're hoping for some place contemplative, but maybe, you know, maybe near built environment so that there could be other accessible facilities. The site certainly does need to have some access to it, whether it's for parking or ADA accessibility. Once you create a public space like that, you want to make sure that everybody can get there and have a similar type of experience. So it's very preliminary at this point, but we'll see what we can find.
That sounds like an incredible challenge to try and find a place that fits all the criteria. But I'm sure that there have been many similar projects where things had to fit in exactly the right way. And I know that, so we have 35 years behind us. And what do we have ahead of us in the next 35 years? Is it possible to make outdoor public art more visible in Albuquerque? What kind of money does that take? What's ahead for us here?
Well, 35 years. I mean, we have the luxury of looking back. I would like to think I could say what's going to happen in the future. But I think that we're going to find ourselves dealing with that question a lot more seriously about sort of the big iconic thing, because there's definitely a hunger for that in the community. We have to figure out where and how, and like you said, finding a place to make this fit. Yeah. And what is that place? But I think we also have the responsibility of continuing to do things that have that community support and buy-in, whether it's a $2,000 mural that's done by kids during this summer break between school on a business owner's wall that really wants something there, whether it's kind of filling in the backlog of public spaces that have been built that we haven't been able to put public art in at the same time it's built, like a lot of the development out on the west side, whether it's community centers or libraries or athletic parks. But I feel confident, we just coming off of the election in October, the voters approved the bonds, the voters approved 1% for art. It yields us about $1.2 million over the next 2 years. Wow. So that's not a lot when you're talking about building, maybe the big observation tower. Yeah. I don't know how we're going to fund that, but it will certainly keep us going. Fortunately, Mayor Barry is very supportive of public art. Good. And we're glad to have his support and his vision. And he's kind of told the Arts Board he has big ideas, but he's turned them loose. He doesn't want to tell them what to do. He's just said, when you come up with some big ideas, come see me. I want to hear them. So I think we're gonna continue to struggle with that. But we've kind of come up with a little bit of a theme about beyond accumulation. We don't want to just kind of keep accumulating just for the sake of accumulating. We want to be more strategic about that. I don't know exactly what that means, because the critical mass that we have is so incredible, and that's how people recognize it. Right. But I think we want to be very mindful of having public art that has an impact for our local citizens. It improves their quality of life. They all agreed that in the survey that, it improves the quality of their life. And, that the visitors notice as well. So, we take it one project at a time. Really, I think that's the best we can do, and just keep asking the voters to support us.
Well, I know the voters will continue to support you, and if it ever looks like they're not, call upon the Mercury to give you a hand, because we would sure love to. Thank you so much for being with us today. It was just a joy to be with you, as always.
Thank you so much. It's so nice to be here, be able to be here and talk about something that I'm so passionate about.